As we approach winter, they're becoming more and more common on our streets, in our classrooms, even in our homes. We've grown up with them. Some people claim to rely on them. However, recent trends are leading community watchdogs to suggest these items of clothing have more sinister undertones. Daniel Coley reports.
Scarves. We've all worn them. On a cold winter's day, they are a familiar sight, adorning our necks, keeping us warm, and protecting us from winter's harshest extremes.
On a busy Wellington street, they appear in all shapes and all sizes, a rainbow of colours wrapped around necks. Some citizens even improvise when a scarf is not available, perhaps in an attempt to appear fashionably conscious. Every year the demand for these fashion accessories increases, and every year the manufacturers continue to surprise the consumer with more and more variety. Yet this surge of scarves into our culture has left many fearful. The decision by local gangs to trade in their recognisable bandanas for family-coloured scarves was viewed as the first move. Now it seems certain that, like the popular hooded sweatshirt, or hoodie, before them, scarves are becoming the subject of a widespread moral panic. The recent bank robbery at a branch of the National Bank has reinforced the suspicion. The robbery, which police have confirmed was not gang-related, has solidified the notion that ordinary civilians are capitalising on the criminal potential of these popular pieces of fabric. In order to discover more, I talked to an expert on the topic, Dr. Glyn Ashton. Dr. Ashton, tell us a bit about yourself and your work.
Well, I am an associate professor of psychology here at Victoria University with a particular interest in the way that fashion influences people's behaviour. How does a garment make them feel physically, the material on the skin? How does that manifest itself emotionally? And what actions do they need to express this?
With this in mind, I took to the streets to search for signs of this moral panic and observed some curious behaviour in one aimless delinquent. I decided that I needed further clarification.
Now, I believe that the base of this moral panic that you're talking about is the way that a scarf can be worn in many different ways, each reflecting something new about its wearer. Now, I always keep a scarf in the office, purely for research and demonstrational purposes.
Of course.
You can imagine. Now, there is the traditional way, which you see a lot, protects the neck. Then, other examples.
I see, right. Magnificent, yes. I see, yes.
Anyway, this fifth example is, I think, of particular interest to our study, in the way that it can cover the face, which is something we're studying, the way that a scarf can conceal an identity. Now, it's a slight subversion of the traditional. Do you see?
I see, yes, yes. At first, many were unwilling to talk.
A few seconds to answer some questions for a doctor, ma'am. Do you want to answer a few questions on
camera? No.
And some showed signs they had been persuaded to keep quiet.
That was my black light, sorry.
Even the ones that did talk were evasive.
These colours, do they represent something to you?
Not really. I just kind of like pink.
But, okay. Yeah. What does that colour represent to you?
I like pink.
You like pink? I mean, I'm sure you're aware of the negative stigma scarves getting in the media a lot with gangs wearing scarves and things like. Do you connect with that at all?
No, not at all. It's more for warmth.
More for warmth, right.
Yeah.
So you're fairly neutral on a lot of the negative stigma that's following scarves recently with the gang affiliations and whatnot.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I don't really think that they wear the same sort of scarves as I do, but yeah.
The colour, is that chosen for a reason?
Yeah, because I like the warm colour.
Right.
It has a warm meaning to me, the red colour. And it fits beautiful to my shoes.
Oh, very very nice, yes. There was a bank robbery over in Molesworth Street earlier that the assailants wore scarves. That's nothing to do with you.
But not my colour scarves.
No, not your colour.
But maybe these people weren't so innocent after all.
Yes, I'm particularly glad they brought up the crime aspect of fashion. A particular area of interest to us are the scarfologically motivated crimes. Yes, scarfologically motivated. I coined that term. Anyway, there's two areas of interest that we're looking at recently. They are the scarf strangulations. The other area of interest is scarf lashings.
Yeah. And more recently, police have been making headlines confronting the problem at hand.
We've been tipped off that in an address in this vicinity, a major police sting is going to go down. The culmination of a 6-month undercover effort. We're going to try and get a camera in there at great personal risk.
The head of the police task force defended their recent
actions. We're not trampling on the rights of everyday Mr. and Mrs. Smith, okay? They're the ones that are the victims here. What we want to stop is the people who are wearing the scarves, people who are committing the crimes. What people need to understand is their rights are being trampled on by these people, not us. We're trying to solve this problem, and we can't do it without your help.
Are you saying that you yourself do not own a scarf?
No, I don't own a scarf. I don't need to own a scarf. There's no need to own a scarf. None of the men and women of my police force wear scarves either. It's not part of the uniform because it's not necessary. In today's climate, with global warming and whatnot, there is simply no need.
However, one man came forward, fearful of persecution, to plead his case.
I've just had an absolute gutsful of the whole situation. You walk down the street and people look at you sideways, as if you're a criminal, some kind of terrorist. They cross the street. All I'm trying to do is keep my neck warm. I know the police have to do their job and we respect them for it, but I just think they've crossed the line. This whole, they're just going after the wrong people. Sure, I do wear a scarf, yeah, I'm cold. Doesn't make me a criminal. I don't care what other people think. It's my choice. I'm not hurting anyone. I walk into a shop, and they won't serve me. No sir, not coming here with a scarf. I'm not a shoplifter. I'm not a criminal. I just want to buy my groceries and get out. Yeah, it covers my face. Maybe I don't want people to see me. It's not a crime. It's even walking around with hoods. Please don't do anything about that. But as soon as you put a scarf on, it's just, it's where you're branded.
With more and more shops and service providers turning away scarf wearers, the seeds of an uprising may already have been planted. This moral panic is also being felt overseas. Similar developments across the Tasman mirror events at home.
Sydney Spring Carnival will now be abandoned at a cost to the industry of tens of millions of dollars.
And with a record shortage of scarves, I have to wonder when this crisis will reach its peak.
It actually looks like all of Wellington is sold out as well. It looks like everywhere are sold out of scarves, sorry. Where are they all going?
You wanna be a rap superstar and live large, big house, 5 cars, you're in charge, coming up in the world, don't trust nobody, gotta look over your shoulder constantly.
It is unsettling, but people should just bide the time and relax.
So you wanna be a rap superstar and live.